Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue, and we have Pursue 6G, which is liver, pancreas, and GI pathology, and we are streaming live from RML New Delhi via Kolkata. And today the topic is pathology of gallbladder and EHBD, and to talk on that we have Dr. Sunaina Mishra, who is a postgraduate from PGI Chandigarh, a PDCC in hepatopathology from ILBS Delhi. Presently, she is an assistant professor in the Department of Pathology at Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute of Medical Sciences, Dr. RML Hospital, New Delhi. She has multiple publications in national and international journals. Before I ask Dr. Mishra to take over, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Mishra, madam, please share your screen and start the presentation. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I can see your screen. Just make it full screen, please.
Yes.
Yeah, sir. Fantastic. Yeah. Just hide that, right? Thank you. Please start.
Good evening, everyone. Before I begin, I would like to express my gratitude to Dr. Nadeem for allowing me and giving me the opportunity to present on this forum. And I'm also very grateful to my teachers at PGI Chandigarh and at GB Pant Hospital, Delhi, where I did my senior residency and was exposed to GI and liver pathology. With that, I begin. And most of my presentation is from WHO digestive diseases and fifth edition and ODES, and also some from reference articles which I have cited duly on the slides. So this is a huge topic, and to give a brief overview of the talk, I'd be covering the pre-invasive intraepithelial neoplasms of the gallbladder adenocarcinoma and subtypes. On the way, I'll discuss certain variants of chronic cholecystitis, but I won't be covering acute and chronic cholecystitis per se. Then in the extrahepatic bile ducts, again, I'd be covering the intraepithelial neoplasm, the malignant epithelial tumors, and the non-epithelial tumors of the gallbladder and extrahepatic bile ducts, just a slide or two on that. Then an important topic of periampullary tumors, how to differentiate between ampullary versus pancreatic ductal versus distal cholangiocarcinomas, and a case-based approach to few of the non-neoplastic lesions of the bile ducts. So gallbladder cancer is especially important in our country because of the high prevalence of gallbladder cancer, especially in the northern part of India. According to the GlobalCAN 2018 data, gallbladder cancer accounts for 1.2% of all global cancer diagnoses and 1.7% of cancer-related deaths. So that shows that it has because it presents at an advanced stage with distant metastasis, the 5-year survival is really low, it's 5%. And that is because gallbladder is not very easily amenable to screening programs, and also the presentation happens at a very late stage, and imaging is also quite non-specific fibrosis and doesn't really form a very mass forming lesions usually, and by the time it infiltrates the liver, it's quite late. Age at presentation is 60 to 80 years with a female preponderance. Female to male ratio is about 3:1. And ethnicity is also important, being more common in Asian Indians and also in Hispanics, American Indians, Native Indian Americans, Mexican Indians, and the Alaskan Natives. In India, especially the Gangetic Belt, it is really important. The age-adjusted incidence rate for females in Delhi is 8.9 compared to South India, Chennai, where it is only 0.8. So this shows the GlobalCan data of 2018. Here we can see that the South American countries, Chile, Bolivia, Colombia, all these are very high incidence areas, and also parts of Central Europe like Poland and Czech Republic. And again, India, the Gangetic Belt, Northern India, wherein the states of Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, and then further going east towards the states of Bihar, Bengal, Assam also. And here we just see, this is the age-adjusted incidence rate per year of gallbladder cancer. This is for the females, the upper one, and this is the males. So we can see over the last 3-4 decades, it has been steadily rising. And in Delhi, it is almost equal to that in Chile and Bolivia, that is almost 20 females per 100,000 individuals. Risk factors of gallbladder cancer are gallstones. The size of the gallstone may matter, because more than 3 centimeter size, that is a longer duration of gallstone wherein it has become larger in size, plays an important role. The duration of the gallstones more than 20 years, body mass index, it is more common in obese individuals, the 4 Fs, that is fat, fertile female, 40s, and infections like chronic typhoid, paratyphoid carriers. Gallbladder is a organ where the typhoid and paratyphoid can stay for many years and is not eliminated. So these are the asymptomatic carriers, wherein it causes chronic irritation of the biliary epithelium and also Helicobacter bilis. So this is the triad where we can see the vulnerable gallbladder. Gallbladder is already, because it's an outpouching from the gastrointestinal tract, and against gravity, it has to sort of push out the bile, which is quite toxic. It contains all the toxic metabolites which have been metabolized by the liver. All these toxic metabolites are present in the bile, and the gallbladder has the function which is also hormonally controlled by the endocrinally controlled by cholecystokinin. It has to push out this bile against gravity into the biliary tract. So the fundus is the one which is most dependent, and that is why also fundus of the gallbladder is most prone, and maximum gallbladder cancers are seen in the fundus region. So there are these risk factors which we discussed: cholelithiasis, porcelain gallbladder, I'll be discussing. Meresis syndrome is nothing but stone impacted in the Hartmann's pouch, that is gallstone impacted in the neck of the gallbladder, causing complications. Gallbladder polyps. Polyps usually more than 1 centimeter are important. Less than 1 centimeter are not clinically very significant. Abnormal pancreaticobiliary junction. Bile duct stones, that is cholelithiasis. Xanthogranulomatous cholecystitis can mimic gallbladder cancer and also can predispose to gallbladder cancer. And stasis, because of any type of hypermotility of the gallbladder, leading to stasis of bile, which will cause increased mucosal time in the gallbladder and cause toxic injury to the biliary epithelium. The host, susceptible host, which is age, middle-aged females, and a more prone parity, multiparous female with a younger age of the first pregnancy, obesity, OCP use, because OCP use causes increased cholesterol uptake and also less of cholesterol degradation, and genetic mutations. Then the toxic environment, infections, that is Salmonella, the typhi, paratyphi, which are the chronic carriers, Helicobacter bilis, Helicobacter pylori, irritants like use of mustard oil and heavy metals. So along the Gangetic Belt, there have been studies which have been done which has shown the presence of these heavy metals in the soil of these areas, like nickel, cadmium, and also pesticides like organochlorine pesticides in these areas, which are also environmental factors, exposure to rubber, coal, wood, and so on. So these are the various factors, the susceptible host and the toxic environment and vulnerable gallbladder. So chronic inflammation that may lead to calcium deposition in the gallbladder wall, that is known as porcelain gallbladder, and 15 to 25% of these are associated with CAGB. Primary sclerosing cholangitis also, I'll be discussing when I discuss the bile duct non-neoplastic lesion that has a strong correlation with both gallbladder as well as cholangiocarcinoma due to the field effect where multicentric tumors may occur. Abnormal pancreatico-biliary junction or the cholecystic-pancreatic junction, which leads to regurgitation of pancreatic juices into the biliary tract, leading to hyperplasia and then metaplasia, dysplasia, and finally neoplastic changes. And this abnormal pancreaticobiliary junction is more prevalent in Japanese population. Gallbladder polyps are rare, affecting 5% of the population, but only if it is a solitary polyp more than 1 centimeter size is it clinically significant. I'll just touch a bit about gallstones. The presence of stones in the gallbladder is known as cholelithiasis, and cholelithiasis is present in the biliary tract, and that could be both intrahepatic as well as extrahepatic. Now, the gallstones can be of three types: the cholesterol stones, black pigment, and brown pigment. Cholesterol can also be mixed type, wherein there is predominantly it is made up of cholesterol and also of calcium salts. So that is most commonly seen. Black pigment stones are seen in chronic hemolytic conditions like sickle cell anemia and malaria, and this happens in sterile bile. So there are mostly the bilirubin polymers which form this bilirubin salts with calcium, and this is found in 2% of the population. Brown pigment stones occur in infected bile. Infected as in those which have been infected with Salmonella and Helicobacter bilis. So these bacterial organisms, they have glucuronidases, and these will deconjugate the bile and form toxic bilirubin metabolites. And therefore, these are also, brown stones are quite highly associated with gallbladder cancer because they are occurring in infected bile ducts. A bit about pathogenesis of the cholesterol stones. Now, there are three steps which are involved in the cholesterol stone formation. There is cholesterol supersaturation in bile, that is excess of cholesterol synthesis and less of excretion. And because of the supersaturation of cholesterol, there is crystal or a nucleation or anidus formation, which forms around the mucin, which is secreted from the gallbladder epithelium as a protective mechanism to protect against the biliary stasis. And around this mucin, anidus will form and stone growth will occur. And as and when the stone grows, as the years pass by and the background shows chronic cholecystitis, and during this time, when the stone becomes more than 3 centimeter, it is said to be more associated with presence of gallbladder cancer. So many times in the gallbladder cancer specimens, you would find impacted stones in the fundus of the gallbladder also. So again, this just highlights the same. Obesity, high calorie diet, anything which increases the cholesterol secretion and cholesterol uptake, female sex hormone, OCPs, drugs like clofibrate, or metabolic disorders which cause decreased activity of cholesterol hydroxylase, anything causing a prolonged parenteral alimentation which causes defective enterohepatic circulation, and there is decrease in bile acids which causes an altered cholesterol to bile ratio. So this arm is causing decrease in bile acids, that is prolonged parenteral alimentation or a rapid loss of bile acids, and this arm is causing increased cholesterol uptake and less of cholesterol degradation. So because of which there is altered cholesterol bile ratio, relative increase in cholesterol, and that will lead to supersaturation of cholesterol within the bile. And this needs a nidus to form the crystals, and that is provided by the mucin. Mucin is secreted by the biliary epithelial cells as a protective mechanism against the bile. And certain conditions like pregnancy, spinal cord injury, rapid weight loss, or prolonged fasting can cause hypomotility of the gallbladder and further aggravate stone formation, because again, they will lead to bile stasis. Again, if the bladder emptying is normal, then sometimes the supersaturated cholesterol crystals can be removed. So cholesterol increase, decrease of bile acids, supersaturation of cholesterol along with hypermotility, that will cause nidus formation. Sometimes they can occur together, sometimes a single factor can also lead to nidus formation, and then that nidus, stone formation with the nidus being formed by the mucin. So symptoms of gallbladder cancer are very vague. They are similar to chronic cholecystitis, most common being pain in the right hypochondrium, weight loss, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and sometimes can also present as lump in the right hypochondrium. And later on, it can when it is advanced, it can cause obstructive kind of jaundice with pruritus, hematemesis, and melena can also be seen very rarely. Coming to porcelain gallbladder, so that is dense posicellular hyaline fibrosis, which transforms the gallbladder wall into a very thin and uniform band. So here you can see that there is no layers which we can make out. Now gallbladder has a mucosa, it has a lamina propria, very thin wisps if present of muscularis, usually submucosa and muscularis is not there. Then it has muscularis propria and the adventitia. So here we cannot make out any of those layers. It is completely transformed into a very thin and a uniform hyalinized band. And many times it is calcified. It is heavily calcified. So that is why it is also known as hyalinizing calcific cholecystitis, which may be seen in 0.5% of cholecystectomies, and around 15 to 20% may be associated with gallbladder cancer. So on gross also, we can see that the wall is quite thinned out. It will be around 0.2 to 0.3. And again, it shows this shiny white mucosal appearance with complete loss of the velvety bile stained mucosa that we normally see. Precursor lesions in the gallbladder. If we see pathways in gallbladder carcinogenesis, there is one adenoma carcinoma pathway, which is seen in less than 5% of the cases. More than 90% of the cases, we have this metaplasia to low-grade dysplasia, high-grade dysplasia, carcinoma or carcinoma in situ, and invasive carcinoma. So this is because of the chronic irritating factors, which we just saw in the previous slides, the risk factors, which will lead to metaplasia, finally dysplasia, and this dysplasia carcinoma sequence is the most plausible oncogenic or the carcinogenic pathway for gallbladder cancer. So low-grade dysplasia to high-grade dysplasia usually takes around 6 to 8 or 10 years, and then high-grade to invasive carcinoma takes a lesser time of around 1 to 2 years. So dysplasia of the biliary tract is seen in 40 to 60% of patients with invasive carcinoma. It does not form a mass, but on the gross specimens, we can see it as a granular or a thickened mucosa. And microscopically also, they're usually flat on or can form very small abortive or micropapillae. And this can be high-grade or low-grade dysplasia, which is known as low-grade or high-grade billing, which is biliary intraepithelial neoplasia. It is the same as in seen in the bile ducts. Prognosis is excellent in low-grade lesion, a cholecystectomy suffices. And in high-grade billing, if we are seeing high-grade billing in a part, so we have to rule out an associated adenocarcinoma. So whenever we gross the gallbladder, always you should take the cystic duct margin. Cystic lymph node should be looked for, and then strips should be separately submitted of the neck, of the body, of the fundus. So in case we see dysplasia in one of those areas, more strips can be taken from that particular region which has been affected. And in high-grade dysplasia, the prognosis would depend on the extent of the disease, whether there is extensive involvement of the Rokitansky-Ashoff sinuses, or whether the cystic duct margin is also positive for intraepithelial neoplasia or not. So just to differentiate on a tabular form, low-grade versus high-grade billing. This is the similarly, the low-grade and high-grade billing is also seen in the biliary tract. So on histology, low-grade billing is flat, pseudopapillary, or it can form small micropapillae. And same is seen in high-grade billing. The low-grade billings have hyperchromatic nuclei. Here the nuclei are hyperchromatic, but sometimes we can see one or two very irregular and highly bizarre looking nuclei. both have high NC ratio. In low-grade villain, there is nuclear stratification. In high-grade villain, there is complex nuclear stratification, which reaches up to the apex, right up to the luminal aspect. Low-grade villain, the nuclear polarity is somewhat maintained, even though there is stratification. In high-grade villain, there is complete loss of nuclear polarity. And they might involve small foci, low-grade villain, whereas extensive multiple foci are involved in high-grade villain. Peribiliary gland involvement is rare in low-grade villain, whereas it is frequently seen in high-grade villains. And Ki-67 index, if we do, it shows a mild to moderate increase in low-grade lesion, this is a marked increase in high-grade lesions. Similarly, IHCs, P53 is usually negative in reactive atypia and also in low-grade dysplasia, whereas it is diffusely nuclear positive in high-grade dysplasia. And P53 can be used in cases where it is difficult to distinguish low-grade or reactive atypia from high-grade dysplasia. P16 is preserved, whereas P16 is lost in high-grade villain. And S100 shows a mild to moderate increase, whereas in high-grade villain, it shows a marked increase. So this figure here, we can see it showing this biliary epithelium with some amount of nuclear stratification. However, the nuclei are quite round and regular with very fine chromatin, and although there is some stratification, but there is inflammation also underneath it. So this would account for reactive versus a very low-grade atypia. Here also there is a single line of basal cells which are present and lot of supra basal mucin, but this is reactive atypia which has occurred. There is no stratification, it is regular uniform single line of cells which we can see. Here there is some amount of stratification, this cigar-shaped pencillate nuclei which can be seen, and although they are not reaching up to the apex, but they are in the lower two-thirds, but there is maintenance of polarity. Some amount of hyperchromasia of the nuclei can be seen, with some showing prominent nucleoli. Again, if we draw a line along the base of the nuclei, they are all well-oriented, there is no loss of polarity. Here also, similarly, we can see this is showing low-grade dysplasia with similar features. If we draw a line along the bases, there is no loss of polarity. These are lesions which are showing high-grade dysplasia. They are reaching the nuclei, reaching up to the apex, and there is quite a lot of nuclear stratification. On low power itself, they look quite blue, and there might be mitotic figures also. And again, if we draw a line, there would be loss of polarization. This is a higher power of high-grade dysplasia. Very bizarre looking, certain nuclei can be seen. There is a lot of nuclear irregularity, and some of them may be discoercive. They will go into the lumen, and intraluminal necrosis may also be seen with loss of polarization. There are certain morphologic features which are needed to distinguish reactive atypia in the gallbladder from dysplasia. And in dysplasia, usually acute inflammation or ulceration is not seen. So if it is associated with a lot of acute inflammation, like acute cholecystitis or acute and chronic cholecystitis, with a lot of neutrophils going into the epithelium, then usually that is a feature of reactive atypia. In reactive atypia, the cells will become clumped, they are cuboidal, and they become more basophilic looking in clusters. And sometimes we can make out intercellular clefts also, like the windows which we see in mesothelial cells. And a lot of times in the dysplasia, we see an abrupt transition between normal and atypical epithelium, which is not a feature of reactive atypia. Wherever there is inflammation, wherever there is regenerative changes, wherever there is a lot of intraepithelial neutrophils, that entire mucosa, either it is ulcerated out, and wherever there is some amount of mucosa which is coming back, that will be showing the reactive or regenerative atypia. Then in dysplasia, usually the chromatin is fine to clump, and in reactive atypia, usually it is very dark. And a prominent nucleoli may be seen in dysplasia, pinpoint nuclei are seen in reactive atypia. Surface maturation is not there in dysplasia, whereas it is there in atypia. And loss of polarization, polarity is seen in dysplasia as compared to, especially high-grade dysplasia as compared to reactive atypia. Another thing is that dysplastic cells, as I said previously, they will express cytoplasmic CEA, they will express CA19-9 along with diffuse P53 and loss of P16. Coming to the next pre-neoplastic lesion, which is the papillary, intrascolecystic papillary neoplasia. So, Billens were the flat lesion, that is low-grade and high-grade dysplasia. Now, intracolecystic papillary neoplasm is an intraductal, non-invasive, mass-forming lesion which arises in the mucosa of the gallbladder and protrudes into the lumen. The female-to-male ratio is 2:1 with a mean age of 60 years. And again, the presentation is right upper outer quadrant pain. ICPN can be associated with low-grade dysplasia or high-grade dysplasia, which is also called intraepithelial neoplasia, or ICPN can be associated with invasion. If there is an ICPN with some amount of invasion, then it is called ICPN with invasion. However, if it is a florid papillary type of tumor, which is a papillary type of adenocarcinoma, where we cannot see any type of a separate polypoidal lesion, then it will be called a papillary adenocarcinoma. Usually, they are more than 1 centimeter in size. As I told previously, less than 1 centimeter size lesions are not clinically significant. And the median size of ICPNs is 2.2 centimeters. They can show biliary, intestinal, gastric or oncocytic type of morphology. Associated invasion or adenocarcinoma is seen in 50% cases, and usually it is more commonly seen with biliary type, which shows high-grade intraepithelial neoplasia. Molecular genetics, it shows KRAS mutations as is seen in intraductal papillary neoplasm of the pancreas also. And it shows GNAS and P53 mutations less commonly. In the IPMNs of the pancreas, intraductal papillary mucinous neoplasms, there were KRAS, GNAS as well as RNF43 mutations. Here, KRAS is more common, KRAS codon 12. However, in India, it has been seen that KRAS codon 13 mutations are more common than codon 12, which are seen in the rest of the world. ICPN with high-grade dysplasia was also called carcinoma in situ. So here we can see this large polypoidal tumor in the fundus of the gallbladder with a lot of papillary excrescences, which will be around 3 centimeters. So this is this polypoid lesion, and the microscopy, we can see the stalk, which is pedunculated with this large papillary tumor, which is forming these complex arborizing papillae. Within them, we can see these cystically dilated tubules and glands. And this is the lining epithelium. Now, this can, the IPMN, sorry, the intracystic cholecystic papillary neoplasms can show different type of morphologies. The gastric foveolar type is commonly seen. So, here we can see these basal nuclei with a lot of suprabasal mucin resembling the gastric foveolar or the Bruna gland-like morphology. These are positive for MUC5AC and CK7, all are positive for CK7. Then this is the pancreatic or biliary type. Usually it shows a lot of high-grade dysplasia, this one. So pancreatic or biliary type also has these complex papillae with very high-grade dysplasia. These are positive for MUC1. And this is the gastric pyloric type, which shows this cuboidal epithelial cells with less of mucin, less of this mucin that we saw in the gastric foveolar type. And it's positive for the MUC6. Intestinal type, which shows these intestinal or colonic type of glands with interspersed goblet cells, which shows positivity for the intestinal mucins. It is MUC2. It is also shows nuclear positivity for CDX2, and also it's positive for CK20. This is the oncocytic type, which shows a lot of eosinophilic granular cytoplasm or the oncocytic cytoplasm, which is rich in mitochondria, and it shows positivity for MUC1. And mixed type of tumors can also be seen, where we see a different type of phenotypes. It can have gastric and pancreatic biliary, or gastric and intestinal also. Then pyloric gland adenomas are simple tumors. Usually they are less than 2 cm, around 1 to 2 cm. And they are also called intracolecystic tubulopapillary neoplasms of the gastric or simple mucinous type. And this is an incidental detection. Usually, they are rarely associated with FAP and Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. And the CT CTNNB1 present on chromosome 3. Mutations in CTNNB1 is seen in 60% of cases, wherein a nuclear translocation of beta-catenin takes place, with beta-catenin showing a nuclear expression. Sometimes they may show a KRAS mutation also, especially if they're more than 1.5 to 2 centimeters. They are completely cured by cholecystectomy. So here, this is a pyloric gland adenoma, and it arises from the gallbladder epithelium and shows these gastric, pyloric and foveolar cells in these long glandular arrangement with lot of mucin and basally oriented nuclei. Mucinous cystic neoplasms, as is seen in the pancreas, can be seen in the biliary tree also. These are the cyst-forming epithelial neoplasms in the liver and the biliary system, and they do not have any communication with the bile duct, however. They show low to intermediate or high-grade dysplasia, and associated invasion, that is mucinous cyst adenocarcinoma, may be seen very rarely. More commonly, they are seen in the liver. Gallbladder and extrahepatic bile ducts are rarely involved. Exclusively, they occur in females, more than 90% of the cases, mean age being 51 years, and KRAS mutation is seen in 20%. And prognosis is excellent if it is completely resected, and usually they are non-invasive. So again, we can see these large cystic spaces, which are lined by these biliary type of tall columnar epithelium, and characteristic ovarian stroma is present in the wall that is positive for estrogen receptor and alpha inhibin, and these are positive on PS and resistant to diastase because they contain mucin and positive for CK7. So this is a mucinous cystic neoplasm of the gallbladder. Liver is more common. It is more commonly seen in the liver and less commonly in the gallbladder and the bile duct. A little bit I'll be covering about the molecular genetics of carcinoma gallbladder. So there is a sequence of mutations that takes place, that is a sequence of molecular alterations that takes place from normal to metaplasia, coming on to dysplasia and high-grade carcinoma in situ and invasive carcinoma. So the important mutations that are involved are mutations of the tumor suppressor genes, that is P53. Then also there is expression of COX-2. COX-2 and the vascular endothelial growth factor and iNOS inducible nitric oxide synthase is also increased, and hypermethylation of promoters of these tumor suppressor genes occurs. That is because of hypermethylation, which is an epigenetic modification. These tumor suppressor genes get inactivated, or their function is lost. And these include inactivation of P53, inactivation of P16 and P21. And again, in dysplasia also the same occurs, along with a loss of heterozygosity of 3P and 8P. Then this FHIT, which is the fragile histidine triad gene, which encodes for the fragile histidine triad protein, is also involved, which is a tumor suppressor gene encoding enzymes that hydrolyze the diadenosine nucleotides, and also cyclin-dependent kinase 2A or the P16 mutations, that is loss of these occur. And finally, in invasive carcinoma, there is oncogenic activation of KRAS, COX-2 again, and the VEGF. So epigenetic modifications also are seen from the normal gallbladder, chronic cholecystitis, there will be pyloric or intestinal metaplasia, then dysplasia, carcinoma in situ, which is high-grade dysplasia, and finally invasive carcinoma. So there is gene hypomethylation which takes place, hypomethylation of genes which are the oncogenic cancerous genes, like UCLH1, which is the ubiquitin esterase L1. Now this gene is also seen in a lot of degenerative familial neurodegenerative diseases. And also there is hypermethylation, that is loss of function of various tumor suppressor genes like ecaderin, P16 and Reprimo, which is a type of P53 inducible gene causing G2 phase arrest. Gallbladder cancer, as I showed previously, is associated in certain racial and ethnic groups. Now these would include the Asian Indians, Hispanics, Eskimos, and also the Native Americans, because of specific polymorphisms in these particular genes, which have been associated with a higher risk of gallbladder cancer, but they need larger studies for validation. Now, important is on frozen section, sometimes we receive for a gallbladder with liver wedge also, where the clinical diagnosis, the radiological diagnosis, xanthogranulomatous cholecystitis versus carcinoma gallbladder. That is because xanthogranulomatous cholecystitis also causes a lot of fibrosing kind of response, which on imaging can mimic a carcinoma gallbladder with infiltration into the liver, also into the duodenum and adjacent colon, because of the extensive amount of fibrosis. And here, however, the epithelium will show a lot of inflammation. It will show regenerative atypia, as I described before, with clumps of these regenerative cells with a lot of basophilic and amphiphilic cytoplasm and shed of denuded mucosa with a lot of intraepithelial neutrophils. And along with that, we see extensive fibrohistiocytic response. And here we can see that we've done the CD68 immunostain, which highlights the foamy histiocytes, and many of them also contain bile. These are bile-laden macrophages, cholesterol clefts, cholesterol crystals can also be seen. So this has to be kept in mind, xanthogranulomatous cholecystitis, especially when a frozen section is sent for a thick-walled gallbladder. Even on cutting, we can see these yellowish areas. But clinically and radiologically, it mimics a gallbladder cancer. And here also on HIPAR, we can see these spheroid and bile-laden macrophages with giant cell formation also. So carcinoma gallbladder, TNM classification according to the 8th edition of AJCC. Now T2 basically has changed compared to the previous 7th edition. T2 has been divided into T2A and T2B. T2A being tumor invading the perimuscular connective tissue on the peritoneal side. Peritoneal side is the free side wherein there is no liver bed. So this is the area of the neck of the gallbladder, parts of the body of the gallbladder, and also the fundus of the gallbladder, those areas which are not connected to the liver bed. And that is T2A, whereas T2B is tumor invades the perimuscular connective tissue on the hepatic side, that is the liver bed, with no extension into the liver. Previously, T2 was just tumor invades the perimuscular connective tissue. It had not defined whether it was the hepatic side or just the serosa. Rest of the things are same in the T classification. Regional lymph node metastasis, earlier it was N0, N1 along the common bile duct, hepatic artery, portal vein. So it was territorially divided, but now it is divided according to number. N1 is metastasis to 1 to 3 regional lymph nodes, whereas N2 is 4 or more regional lymph nodes, because that was more clinically significant. So this is a specimen of cancer gallbladder, wherein you can see that there are impacted stones also, the cholesterol stones in the gallbladder wall, quite thick walled, and we can see that the lumen is almost obliterated by this thick whitish growth. This is the area of the neck, and the specimen has been bivalved, and this is the liver bed. But here, grossly, we cannot see any infiltration into the liver parenchyma. So this would be grossly correlating to T2B. Now, margins which are important to be taken are the cystic duct margin, and it has to be reported whether it is uninvolved by invasive carcinoma and high-grade intraepithelial neoplasia also. And if it is uninvolved, then a radial margin may be taken if it is somewhere in the neck region. If it is in the fundus, then we can just give the distance of the invasive carcinoma from the margin grossly. If the cystic duct margin is involved by invasive carcinoma or is involved by high-grade biliary intraepithelial neoplasia, that also has to be documented. The liver parenchyma margin has to be given if it is applicable, if the liver bed is included. It is either involved by the carcinoma or it is uninvolved. This is the surgical margin. This one, which is stapled also, there is a lot of staples which are put, and this is the ragged margin which has to be painted. Here grossly it is free, but in case there is infiltration in the form of tongues, then we have to properly take it by painting, and here only a shaved margin will do. And if there are other organs also which have been taken out, sometimes when there is a lot of adhesion, they might take out the duodenum, sometimes the colon, then those margins have to be also included. Histologic types, adenocarcinoma, intestinal, biliary and gastric foveolar type, which will show the mucin phenotype as was in the previous, as it was in the ICPNs, which I discussed previously. Mucinous adenocarcinoma show more than 50% extracellular mucin. Poorly coercive carcinoma can be with or without signet ring cells. Signet ring cells, the classical signet ring morphology as is seen in signet ring carcinoma of the stomach, or like the plasmacytoid morphology which is seen in urothelial carcinomas. And clear cell carcinoma, which is the hypernephroid variant, adenosquamous carcinoma, where there is adeno component and also squamous component, which should be more than equal to 25% of the tumor. So multiple sections need to be taken. A pure squamous cell carcinoma is very rare. Even if we see 1% of glandular component, it becomes adenosquamous. So if we are reporting pure squamous cell carcinoma, we have to extensively sample the tumor before we report it as a pure squamous cell carcinoma. Other patterns can be seen like undifferentiated carcinoma, medullary or the lymphoepithelial carcinoma, sarcomatoid, and then there is carcinoma not otherwise specified. So this is from the WHO 5th edition, wherein we can see this gallbladder cancer, which is infiltrating into the liver bed, and a stone is also associated. This is a pancreatic biliary type, which is infiltrating into the muscularis propria. The intestinal type would appear as the colonic or the intestinal colorectal carcinomas with these cribriform to back-to-back placed glands with elongated or these ancillate nuclei, hyperchromatic nuclei. This is the gross of a mucinous or the signet ring type of tumor, which shows a lot of thick mucin and it's glistening on gross also. And signet rings are present on morphology, floating within this extracellular mucin. Mucin should be more than 50%. This is poorly cohesive type of tumor, which gives a plasmacytoid morphology without signet ring cells. Sarcomatoid carcinoma, just like sarcomas, can present like this fleshy polypoidal mass, and on microscopy it shows this spindle like proliferation of these malignant cells, which show positivity for cytokeratin. At least pan cytokeratin has to be positive in these cases. And bizarre giant cells can also be seen in sarcomatoid carcinomas. Again, this is a picture of mucinous, where you can see abundant pools of extracellular mucin with some floating glands and cells. The clear cell type, which shows these rounded nuclei, very vesicular chromatin, pinpoint nuclei, and distinct cell borders, or the hypernephroid variant, because it mimics renal cell carcinoma. And if we are seeing only this clear cell pattern, which is not mixed with other patterns, then a metastatic renal cell carcinoma may need to be ruled out, because clear cell pattern itself exclusively is very rare. So that can be done by renal cell carcinoma is CK7 negative, whereas the clear cell gallbladder cancer is going to be CK7 positive, and RCC is going to be positive for RCC antigen, taxate, and carbonic anhydrase 9. Similarly, this is the undifferentiated type, which does not show any differentiation. There are these very bizarre cells within this tumor. The medullary or the lymphoepithelial cell type, which shows these syncytial circumscribed tumor nodules with a lot of prominent lymphocytic rich palisading or the lymphocytic rich stroma. And the hepatoid type, which shows this prominent eosinophilic or oncocytic eosinophilic glassy eosinophilic cytoplasm. Additional pathologic findings which need to be mentioned are either there are no findings or there is cholelithiasis. Usually there is chronic cholecystitis associated dysplasia. If we are seeing billing, either there is dysplasia or if there is any adenoma. Intestinal metaplasia also is important if we are seeing, and porcine gallbladder, or if there is primary sclerosing cholangitis in that patient, that has to be mentioned. There are certain features to distinguish dysplasia or in situ carcinoma from which is extending into Rokitansky-Ashoff sinuses from invasive carcinoma. So that is really important, because the gallbladder does not have the submucosa and muscularis mucosa. Muscularis mucosa is usually, if present, there might be very thin wisps. So because of that, lamina propria, and then directly we have the muscularis propria. So it is important to distinguish dysplasia and in situ carcinoma, which is extending into the RA sinuses, which are just indippings of the mucosa because of the chronic obstructive conditions, and from invasive carcinoma. Now, dysplasia and in situ carcinoma usually is not associated. This is misplaced epithelium or just in extending into the RA sinuses, which are therefore not associated with any desmoplastic response. Also, if there is involvement of the muscularis propria itself, that is direct involvement of the muscularis propria, or we see perineural and vascular invasion on the adventitial or the serosal aspect, that is more prominently seen in invasive carcinoma. That is desmoplasia, involvement of the muscularis propria in whole, or a lot of perineural or vascular invasion that is not seen in situ or dysplastic conditions. Similarly, if there is connection of the surface epithelium, somewhere we see connection of the surface epithelium, or we are seeing small to medium sized glands, that is seen usually in dysplasia, and presence of luminal bile with mixture of benign and atypical glands is seen in dysplasia or carcinoma in situ. But sometimes, especially, it's very difficult to distinguish early gallbladder cancer from dysplasia, because early gallbladder cancer would be limited to the lamina propria. So this is a picture from WHO where we can very clearly see that these are the indippings of the epithelium, surface epithelial collection can be seen, and this is dysplasia which is extending into the Rokitansky-Ashcroft sinuses rather than carcinoma itself. However, if they are tangentially cut or we get only transverse sections within the muscularis propria, then we have to rely on the desmoplastic stromal response and other features, because gallbladder and cholangiocarcinomas usually incite a lot of desmoplasia, unlike the pancreatic carcinomas. Another important thing to remember, especially when there is infiltration along the hepatic side, is the presence of these biliary glands, peribiliary glands, which may be present. Now, these are the mucous glands which have a normal lobulated architecture, which are composed of uniform, evenly sized tubules. So there we can see in the peribiliary glands, they have this lobular architecture, which are in the form of these lobules, and they have this different type of stroma around them. So these are the benign peribiliary glands, which are seen on the serosal aspect at the hepatic or the liver bed. And also they are seen in the neck and the cystic duct region. P53 is not positive. If positive, it's very weak, and CEA does not show diffuse cytoplasmic positivity, and it shows a weak positivity. Sometimes carcinoma can involve the benign peribiliary glands also, causing cancerization of the peribiliary glands. Then there are certain pseudotumors which mimic a neoplasia, like the fibroglandular type polyps. This is a benign fibroepithelial polyp, and the adenomyomatous nodule of the gallbladder. And these are just irregular clusters of pyloric type glands arranged in a lobular pattern separated by myoid type of stroma, and they resemble hematomatous polyps. Prognosis of gallbladder cancer, which is confined to the superficial muscle, is potentially curable by cholecystectomy. Cystic duct margin status, involvement of Rokitansky-Ashcroft sinus, and extent of the carcinoma is the predictor of progression. However, in the advanced, that is beyond early cancer, that is stage 2A or 2B, they have a worse prognosis. And now they have divided into 2A and 2B because 2A tumors do better than 2B tumors. That is, the hepatic side does worse as compared to the serosal side. And in invasive tumors, the 5-year survival is very less. It is 45% around. And especially when they present at very advanced stage, the 5-year survival is less than 5%. Now, this is one entity that I'm discussing. Sometimes a liver nodule is received, and there is a doubt of whether it is a metastatic nodule from a cholangiocarcinoma or from the gallbladder cancer. But these are bile duct adenomas, which are the peribiliary hamartomas, which are very localized, solitary, discrete nodules, subcapsular in location. They can be multiple also. And they have these small tubules lined by cuboidal epithelium within a collagenous stroma. Sometimes they may contain bile, but usually they do not contain bile. And these are the peribiliary hematomas, which are very innocuous. And although sometimes they may get frozen section for that, for a metastatic carcinoma. And here again, they are not haphazardly arranged, and they are not within a desmoplastic stromal response. But the gross is quite diagnostic. There is no infiltrative type of pattern. They are very circumscribed, punched out, whitish nodules. Coming on to the extrahepatic bile ducts. First, I just discussed the gross anatomy. So there are the interlobular branches of the bile ducts, which are seen in the portal tracts. And these are connected to the cholangiocytes and the canals of Herring. That is where the bile is drained from. So these small interlobular bile ducts would then drain into the septal bile ducts, which are part of the small intrahepatic bile ducts. They would then form the larger intrahepatic bile ducts. These large intrahepatic bile ducts would be the area and the segmental ducts, which would then drain into the left and the right hepatic ducts. They would join and form at the confluence the common hepatic duct. So anything beyond the confluence of the right and the left hepatic duct, which is the common hepatic duct, to where it joins the gallbladder cystic duct, is known as the perihilar region. And this is also part of the extrahepatic bile ducts. Anything before the confluence of the right and left hepatic ducts are the intrahepatic ducts. So once the right and the left hepatic ducts have joined to form the common hepatic ducts, from that area till it joins the cystic duct of the gallbladder, it is known as the common hepatic ducts. Once the cystic duct of the gallbladder joins, this is known as the common bile duct, which would then course through the intrapancreatic portion and then join the pancreatic duct at the ampulla of Peter. And this is the distal, actually this entire is the extrahepatic region, that is right from the cystic duct to the ampulla of Peter, but especially the intra pancreatic portion is known as the distal extrahepatic ducts. It is really important because this is where the ampullary carcinomas arise, periampullary. So here we have the DD of the pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma, the distal cholangiocarcinoma, and the ampullary tumors also. Somehow this picture is, I'll just try. Sorry for that. So important is choledochoid cysts because they are also preneoplastic conditions as the abnormal pancreatico-biliary junction. Now choledochoid cysts are divided as per the Todani's classification into five types. These choledochoid cysts, the first type is fusiform dilatation. Fusiform dilatation of the extrahepatic bile duct. That is type 1. This is the gallbladder, this is the fusiform dilatation of the extrahepatic bile duct, that is type 1. Type 2 is focal saccular or a diverticulum type of dilatation of the extrahepatic duct. So this is type 2. Then type 3 is cystic duct dilatation, which is confined to the duodenal wall, which is also called as choledochoid seal. So if I explain, this is the gallbladder, this is the bile duct, and this is the pancreatic duct. So this is in the duodenal wall where it has joined the pancreatic duct. This is the choledochoid seal. This is a sac-like or the diverticulum-like dilatation, which is the type 2, and a saccular or fusiform dilatation is type 1. And type 4 is combined intra and extrahepatic dilatation of the bile ducts. Type 4A is basically intra and extrahepatic, whereas type 4B is only extrahepatic, and type 5 is multiple intrahepatic dilatation, which is also known as Carolis disease. So this is the gallbladder and this is the choledochoid seal. So this is a type of fusiform or a single type 1 choledochoid seal, where it is dilatation of the extrahepatic bile duct, fusiform type of dilatation. And if we see, these are microscopically, they show the stall columnar biliary type of epithelium. Inflammation might be seen, and also they will show peribiliary glands in their wall. Coming to the preneoplastic condition, which is the intraductal papillary neoplasm of the bile ducts, or IPNB. Intraductal papillary or villous type growth into the bile duct, which are lined by biliary epithelium, and they can occur in both the intra as well as extrahepatic bile duct. And usually they present with recurrent intermittent abdominal pain and with features of cholangitis. In Eastern Asia, it's really important because it constitutes 10 to 38% of the bile duct tumors, especially in Cambodia, Vietnam, and these regions. Risk factors for IPNB is primary sclerosing cholangitis, hepatolithiasis for the intrahepatic ones, and liver fluke infestation. So I'll be discussing a bit about liver fluke infestation in the subsequent slides. Then again, here it can have low-grade dysplasia, that is intraductal papillary neoplasm of bile duct with low-grade dysplasia, high-grade dysplasia, and invasive carcinoma. Again, here there is a stepwise acquisition of molecular alteration which affects the oncogenic pathways, that is KRAS, P53, and GNAS are involved, and GNAS mutations are usually seen in intestinal differentiation. And again, when there is overexpression of EZH2, IMP3, and DMT1, that is associated with invasion. So here we see the different growth patterns. This is a polypoidal type of growth pattern, which is presenting as a polypoidal mass within the lumen and also spreading along the duct system. And this is a papillovillus type of growth pattern, where we can see along with the mass, there are these numerous finger-like projections which of the tumor. And this is IPN with invasion. That is, the yellow part is showing invasion into the liver parenchyma. So this is the normal biliary system, the left and the right hepatic ducts and the common hepatic ducts, the bile duct and the common bile duct. So here there is a lesion in the extrahepatic bile duct in the perihilar region, and that is causing a lot of proximal biliary radical dilatation, which is also known as IRHBD, which can be seen on radiology also. Because of this constrictive lesion here, there is proximal dilatation. Again, this is another tumor which is causing both distal as well as proximal IHRBD, and that is because this tumor sometimes also secretes a lot of mucin. Because of this mucin secretion, there is distal as well as proximal dilatation, and dilatation now is happening on both sides, the right as well as the left. Now again, here there is both distal and a lot of excessive intrahepatic bile duct radical dilatation in the left side because of the mucin secretion. And this is liver infiltration, which can be seen along with the IHRBD. So intraductal papillary neoplasia of the bile ducts are divided into type 1 and type 2. Type 1 and type 2, based on their location and also on the histology. Type 1 is present in the intrahepatic ducts, whereas type 2 are seen more commonly in the extrahepatic ducts. Excessive mucin production is frequently seen in type 1, whereas it's rare in type 2. And the lining epithelium is regular, homogeneous, or it can be papillary and tubular. In type 2, it's more complex, heterogeneous, and papillary tubular, and sometimes it can show cribriform to solid type of pattern also. The subtype in type 1 is gastric and intestinal, as it's also frequently associated with excessive mucin, whereas in type 2, it is pancreatic or biliary type, which is more commonly seen. And type 1 usually show high-grade features with foci of low to intermediate grade. But type 2 are almost always high grade only, and foci of low to intermediate grade are almost never seen. Stromal invasion is less common in type 1 and more common in type 2. So aggressiveness is more in type 2 as compared to type 1. So here, this is a picture which is showing intrahepatic intraductal papillary neoplasm of the bile duct, and here we can see this multicystic lesion with some areas showing solid and papillary lesions, and this again is showing this large papillary polypoidal tumor within the bile duct. This is also intrahepatic tumor, this polypoidal small papillary nodules which can be seen, and it is associated with liver invasion, and there is so much of bile duct dilatation also. Again, this is the intestinal type, which is showing these long, very finger-like villus projections, which is reminiscent of villus adenomas, which are seen in the colorectal region. So they have these very thin, long, finger-like fronds or villi, and stratified nuclei, and they can be reaching up to the apex with lot of penciling of the nuclei and mitosis reaching up to the apex in high-grade dysplasia. This is the gastric type, where we can see a lot of complex arborizing papillae and a lining of gastric pyloric type of cells. Type 1, as I showed, they show these regular or homogeneous type of papillae. Some papillary tufting can be seen with mucin secretion might be there, whereas type 2 shows much more complex arborizing papillae and a heterogeneous type of growth, and it is usually associated with high-grade dysplasia. Coming to the IHC profile, they all show positivity for keratin 7 and 19, the gastric, intestinal, pancreatic, biliary and oncocytic type, whereas keratin 20 is seen, and MUC2 and CDX2 is seen in intestinal type. Gastric type shows positivity for MUC5AC, gastric pyloric shows positivity for MUC6, pancreatic biliary type and oncocytic type show positivity for MUC1, and they may show positivity for MUC6. So intestinal type will be positive for keratin 20, MUC2 and CDX2. Differential diagnosis of intraductal papillary neoplasia of the bile ducts include micropapillary biliary intraepithelial neoplasia. So usually the biliary intraepithelial neoplasia are flat lesions, but they can sometimes form micropapillary projections or tufting. And however, they are less than 3 millimeter in height. And they are usually intermixed with the flat or the pseudopapillary type of villain. So these micropapillary tufts are not seen throughout the lesion. They might be intermittently seen intermixed with the flat lesions. And they are usually not very tall. They are less than 3 millimeter as compared to the IPNBs. Then intraductal tubulopapillary neoplasm is also a type of IPNB, which is formed by these tubules which are present in densely packed cribriform like arrangement, and they have very high grade dysplasia. They have no mucin content and they are negative for mucin stains. So this is cribriform like pattern, densely back to back arranged tubules which are present and no mucin, very high grade nuclei. Intraductal polypoid mets from extrahepatic organs may be present, wherein they are metastasizing from the serosal aspect and then forming polypoidal mets into the mucosa rather than being pre-invasive mucosal lesions. Coming to cholangiocarcinomas, as I showed, based on the location, are divided into the intrahepatic, that is before the confluence of the right and the left hepatic duct, perihilar, that is from the confluence of the left and right hepatic duct to the cystic duct, and the extrahepatic and the distal cholangiocarcinomas. So the here we can see that the distal cholangiocarcinomas take up around 30% and the perihilar cholangiocarcinoma take up around 60%, whereas the intrahepatic take up around 10% of the cholangiocarcinomas. Now, age is 60 to 70 years. Males are more commonly affected than females, and the cholangiocarcinomas present earlier than carcinoma GB because they present with obstructive jaundice. If there is a mass at the ampulla of the Vater, if it's a distal cholangiocarcinoma, it is going to cause occlusion of the lumen and it is going to cause obstructive jaundice. So they usually present much earlier as compared to carcinoma GB. And exact localization of the tumor can be done by magnetic resonance cholangiopancreaticography or the ERCP, endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreaticography. A much higher frequency is seen in Eastern Asian countries, especially Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, and Korea. Risk factors for extrahepatic and intrahepatic, some are similar but some are different. I'll be discussing for extrahepatic cholangiocarcinomas, which are bile duct cysts or the choledochal cysts, which we just discussed. Carolee's disease, which is also a type 5 choledochal cyst, primary sclerosing cholangitis, or also secondary cholangitis like recurrent pyogenic cholangitis or parasitic cholangitis, especially due to Clonorchis sinensis and Ophthalmorchis viverini. Choledocholithiasis, inflammatory bowel disease, ulcerative colitis, which is associated with PSC, chronic pancreatitis, and thoroidrust injections. This is a picture which shows this dish which is known as Khoipla from Thailand, and this is the northeastern province of Thailand on the Konkan province, where there is highest incidence of liver fluke associated cholangiocarcinoma. This is made from raw fish, this cyprinid fish, which is eaten raw with salad and some other herbs. And basically, when the individual gets infected with the liver fluke, that is Ophiothorhynchus or Clonorchis sinensis, then the organism is going to reside in the biliary duct. The adult worm is formed, which is residing in the biliary duct for many years, and the embryonated eggs are going to be passed in the feces. The water gets contaminated and with the feces, and from there the first intermediate host is the snail. In the snail, the sporocysts are going to form, and these are going to divide into Sersaria after multiple asexual divisions. These Sersaria are freely motile, and they are going to be present in the water, and they will encyst within the scales, within the muscle of this fish, cyprinid fish. And when this fish is eaten raw, in the raw form, then these metasarsaria, which are present in the fish underneath the scale, in the muscle or the flesh of the fish, they are going to enter into the intestine, and from the duodenum, from the ampulla, they migrate into the biliary tree, where they develop into, they undergo multiple developmental stages, develop into the adult worms, and they reside there for more than 10 to 15 years and are very difficult to clear off and cause chronic irritation of the biliary tract. And that is how they are carcinogenic. And it is important to note that liver fluke associated cholangiocarcinomas are associated with mutations in P53, KRAS and SMAD4 as seen in the other tumors. So here if we see, the extrahepatic cholangiocarcinomas are associated with these various mutations, ARID1B, PRACA, PRACB mutations, and also cholangiocarcinoma usually is not associated with any genetic syndromes. It usually shows somatic associations. Important also is the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma shows IDH1 and IDH2 mutations as compared to extrahepatic, which shows KRAS, P53. And SMAD4 loss in addition to these various mutations. There is also the stem cell theory or the stem cell hypothesis. The stem cell niche for the intrahepatic and the extrahepatic biliary tree are highlighted. The red ones are the intrahepatic, whereas these are the peribiliary glands where the stem cells are. And in the intrahepatic, the stem cells are localized in the canals of Herring and at the limiting sulcus, and these show positivity for EpCAM and CD44. And in the distal region, there is a higher abundance of these peribiliary glands also around the cystic duct. So that is where the stem cell hypothesis comes in. That is, the biliary progenitor can undergo transformation into both cholangiocytes, that gives rise to the pancreatic or biliary type, or the goblet cell, which gives rise to the mucin producing intestinal type. Staging of cholangiocarcinoma has changed quite a bit. Earlier, it was dependent on where it is invading. That is, T2 was invading beyond the wall of the bile duct, T3 was tumor invading gallbladder, pancreas, duodenum, or adjacent organs. Now it is based on the depth of invasion. That is, T1 is depth less than 5 mm, T2 is 5 to 12, and more than 12 mm is T3. Similarly, the regional lymph nodes have been defined. N1 is metastasis to 1 to 3, and N2 is more than 4, whereas previously it was N0 being no regional lymph node and N1 being regional lymph node metastasis. So cholangiocarcinomas, grossly, they are sclerosing, nodular or papillary type. Here we can see this papillary type of tumor, and it is present inside, infiltrating the entire wall of the duct. The stage of the disease is the most important prognostic factor. And resectable lesions, the 5-year survival is good. However, not very good. It is 20 to 30%. However, it declines to less than 5%, reaching zero in unresectable diseases. Papillary have better prognosis, that is intraluminal more than the non-papillary. And poor prognosis is associated with poorly differentiated types with lymphovascular or nodal metastasis. Another important point that I wanted to discuss was the ampullary or the periampullary lesions. So this is showing, the blue color is showing the ampullary tumor that is arising from the duodenal papilla. This green color is showing the duct, bile duct tumor, that is the distal bile duct tumor, which is arising from the wall of the bile duct, whereas this red color is showing the pancreatic head carcinoma, which is also spreading along the pancreatic duct. So the reported frequency of bile duct origin and periampullary carcinoma ranges from 5 to 17%. Now distal cholangiocarcinoma are commonly serous and constricting concentric lesions which form circumferential thickening and grow along the distal bile duct, the intra pancreatic portion of the bile duct. And microscopically, I'll discuss, and it is important because the survival of ampullary, which arises from the duodenal mucosa, is much better than pancreatic and distal bile duct tumors. So the worst is pancreatic ductal, then comes the distal bile duct tumor, and then the ampullary tumor. Also, an important finding is the low union CBD in the distal bile duct tumors. That is, a low union CBD means the cystic duct is joining the common hepatic duct in the intrapancreatic portion. So here in the green is your cystic duct, and the yellow is the common hepatic duct, which is joining within the pancreatic parenchyma. So this is the low union of CBD, which is seen many times in distal cholangiocarcinomas. So here again, we can see this serous whitish growth, which is present along the common bile duct, which is showing this wall thickening. And that is what is seen on microscopy. On microscopy, you see this concentric type of tubules, which are arranged around the common bile duct. And this is also on this picture, we can see on a higher magnification, these concentric type of tubules, which are arranged around the common bile duct, which are kind of infiltrating below the bile duct wall. And microscopically, it shows the similar type of glandular and tubular arrangement as is seen in the pancreatic or biliary type of tumors. Again, this image shows the concentric bile duct involvement, and these glandular tubular structures are present concentrically around the bile duct, these tubular units. And the surrounding bile duct, if we take strips of the bile duct, we can see high-grade villin in the form of these micropapillary tufting and this apical nuclear stratification and high NC ratio. Again, these are the different variants which are showing these tubular. Usually, the distal cholangiocarcinoma has a tubular type of morphology. This is the tubular, which sort of resembles the ductal type of tumor of breast, and a lot of fibrotic stroma, because these are very serous tumors. And here again, this is the clear cell type. This is the foamy type or the vacuolated cell type. And this one shows the intestinal type of differentiation. And the last one here, we have these syncytial tumor cells with lymphoepithelial stroma, lymphoidroid stroma, the medullary type. Now, non-epithelial tumors, or the mesenchymal tumors, are less than 1%. Hemangiomas, these benign tumors like hemangiomas, lymphangiomas can be seen. Sarcomas, embryonal, rhabdomyosarcoma is the most common malignant tumor in children in the gallbladder. Lymphomas are usually of the MALT type. And distal CBD, we can see granular cell tumors, which will show these dense granular cytoplasm, abundant granular cytoplasm, positive for S100. And secondary tumors can be seen, metastasis of melanoma, lymphomas, and so on. Last, I would be discussing a few non-neoplastic lesions. So before that, cholangitis is non-neoplastic disease of the intrahepatic and the extrahepatic bile ducts that are collectively called as cholangiopathies. That is, the biliary epithelial cells are the primary target of the disease process. Now, cholangitis is usually when it is associated with right upper quadrant pain, fever, and jaundice, that is also known as the Charcot's triad. And when there is delirium, mental status changes with sepsis, that is known as the Raynaud's pentad. Now, important is primary sclerosing cholangitis, which needs to be differentiated from a variety of secondary sclerosing cholangitis, most importantly the IgG4 related cholangitis, because that also causes a lymphocytic type of cholangitis, lymphocytic type fibrosing, follicular cholangitis, graft versus host disease, not very commonly seen. Infectious, which is the pyogenic cholangitis. If there is recurrent pyogenic cholangitis, it can cause a fibrosing type of morphology. Fungal, parasitic, AIDS-associated, gastro-CMV cholangitis, vascular injury, which is ischemic cholangiopathy. This is really important because the bile ducts are supplied solely by the hepatic artery branches. Neoplastic, like Langerhans cell histiocytosis, malignant infiltration, drug-induced, like amoxiclav, phenytoin. Genetic causes like Alagille syndrome, cystic fibrosis, ductal plate malformations, and idiopathic is biliary atresia, which is seen in the neonatal period. I'll be focusing on these few entities. So this was a 35-year-old male who presented with fever, pruritus, and right upper quadrant pain with raised alkaline phosphatase on liver function test. And here on Mason's trichrome stain, we can see this periductal fibrosis, which is classically known as onion skinning type of fibrosis, and this is the high part which I have taken, and here also we can see this classic onion skinning type of fibrosis and very little inflammation. So this is a case of primary sclerosing cholangitis, and it has to be differentiated from IgG4 related. This is florid IgG4 related, which we got IgG4 related cholangitis, and here we can see this periductal fibrosis along with this florid inflammation, and this inflammatory infiltrate is rich in plasma cells which are positive on IgG4 immunostain also, and again this periductal inflammation and this type of bland collagenous or storiform fibrosis. However, phlebitis is sometimes not very commonly seen in IgG4 related disease in the bile ducts. So this was IgG4 cholangitis. Now, primary sclerosing cholangitis has autoimmune haplotype HLA-A1-BAD3. That is, autoantibodies are there against peptides which are shared by biliary epithelial cells as well as colonic cells. That is why 50% have history of ulcerative colitis, IBD, inflammatory bowel disease. Usually affects males which are less than 45 years. May be asymptomatic in 25% of cases where the screening is done in a patient with IBD, ulcerative colitis. They can have cholangitis-like features with fever, upper quadrant pain, and jaundice and pruritis. On MRCP, there are multifocal strictures which are seen involving the intra as well as extrahepatic bile ducts, which are short annular with alternate dilated segments. 5 to 10% cases are confined to the intrahepatic tree, 5 to 10% are confined to the larger ducts, whereas most of the cases show both intrahepatic as well as extrahepatic involvement. And we need to exclude any previous bile duct surgery, bile duct injury. There should be no colidocholithiasis and obviously exclusion of any malignancy. Perinuclear neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibodies are found in 87% of the patient, but not disease specific. Cholestatic profile in liver function test with raised alkaline phosphatase and GGT. And fibro obliterative response, that is the onion skinning type of periductal fibrosis. Sometimes the onion skinning fibrosis is so florid where the duct is completely obliterated and we just see the round fibrotic response. And there is degenerative atrophy of the epithelium. In the early stages, especially, we can see periductal lymphoplasmacytic infiltration, which may mimic IgG4 related cholangitis. And treatment is UDCA with immunosuppressive therapy, and sometimes it may show overlap syndrome with AIH-PBC, which may be simultaneous or sequential. IgG4 related cholangitis affects usually patients older than 50 years, male to female ratio of 3:1. It may be associated with systemic disease, autoimmune pancreatitis, or extrabiliary disease, other in organ involvements. It can mimic cholangiocarcinoma radiologically due to presence of strictures or mass lesion pseudotumor and obstructive jaundice. There is elevated serum IgG4 levels, and usually it is seen in the distal intrapancreatic or also in the hilar bile ducts. The classic triad of IgG4 related disease will be seen: dense lymphoplasmacytic infiltrate and fibrosis. Obliterative phlebitis may or may not be seen, usually seen in the hilar region. And gallbladder is also involved, where you can get IgG4 related cholecystitis. And treatment is with steroids, this showed dramatic improvement. So this table from Maxwin just highlights the difference between PSC and IgG4 related. IgG4 occurs in younger people as compared, PSC occurs in younger people as compared to IgG4 related sclerosing cholangitis. Males are more commonly affected in both. And IgG4 related disease presents with obstructive jaundice because of mass and pseudotumor like effect. And diseases, inflammatory bowel disease in primary sclerosing cholangitis versus autoimmune-related systemic disease in IgG4-related sclerosing cholangitis. Then lab findings here, ANCA may be seen, ANA may be positive, whereas HLA association is different between the two cases, and elevated IgG4 levels are seen in more than 80% of IgG4 related sclerosing cholangitis. Histology, I have discussed the classic triad of IgG4 related disease. Phlebitis may or may not be seen, whereas in PSC there is the fibro-obliterative type of cholangitis, minimal inflammation, and there is ductopenia with concentric periductal fibrosis. So coming to the next entity, ischemic cholangitis, blood supply to the biliary system is exclusively by the hepatic artery and its branches. So post liver transplant, post iatrogenic injuries, or sometimes in metastatectomy, there is infusion of chemotherapeutic agents like 5-fluorouracil into the hepatic artery. So that can cause ischemic type of changes in the bile duct. And they may be confined to one segment or may affect discontinuous segments. So in acute, there is ischemia and sloughing off. Just like we see mucosal gangrene, there is this ischemic type of necrosis with sloughing off of the bile duct epithelium and this intraluminal type of necrosis which is seen. And chronically, there is fibrosis with obliteration of the lumen. So here also it causes periductal fibrosis, but there is bile duct injury with this overlapping. Some areas there is loss of the epithelium and overcrowding of epithelium. And here, of course, we would need the history. Large duct obstruction. It is seen in choroidocolithiasis, bile duct injury due to iatrogenic causes like stents, Q-tube, metallic clip insertion, or they can be due to surgery, fistula or diverticular formation. Sometimes tumor can cause large duct obstruction, periampillary or the lymph nodal obstruction of the distal bile duct. Presentation is with Charcot's triad depending on the kind of stenosis caused. It can be acute or chronic, and it can cause partial or complete stenosis of the bile duct. And there is a cholestatic picture on liver function test with elevated alkaline phosphatase, gamma glutamyl transaminase, and the conjugated or the direct hyperbilirubinemia. And chronic, there will be pruritus, coagulopathies, and portal hypertension. So histopathology, in the acute cases, there are parenchymal changes. Firstly, there is zone 3 or centrizonal cholestasis. And the portal changes in the acute stage is loose edematous fibrosis, portal inflammation, composed of neutrophils with periportal ductular proliferation. And in the chronic stages, we have parenchymal changes in the form of collate stasis, ballooning degeneration, or a Mallory Denk formation can be seen. That is, these intracytoplasmic filaments which get condensed, and increased copper associated protein, that is biliary type of interface, is seen. And the portal changes is biliary type of fibrosis, jigsaw, ductular reaction, and mild chronic inflammation. I'll be showing the images. So this is the central vein. Zone 3 or the centrally venular cholestasis is the parenchymal change, and on the portal change, we are seeing loose edematous fibrosis, ductular proliferation with these inspissated bile plugs, neutrophilic infiltrates which are chemotactic to the bile, and loose edematous fibrosis in acute. And the DD is drug induced cholestasis, which can also show steroids can show this zone 3 erivenular cholestasis, and sepsis or cholangitis lenta, where there are these massively dilated cholangioles which are present in the duct with inspissated bile, and again they would also show neutrophilic infiltrate because neutrophils, bile is chemotactic to neutrophils. Now the chronic picture is this chronic biliary or jigsaw puzzle type of cirrhosis, and this picture is from Maxwin, whereas this I have taken, and here we can see the halo effect. What is halo affect basically the stromal edema, ductular proliferation, and the scoliate stasis, which is seen in the periportal hepatocytes. Scoliate stasis, that is because of the detergent action of the bile acids. There is presence of this vacuolation of the cytoplasm, and if we do an orsine stain, we can see copper associated proteins here, and this florid ductular reaction which is seen. And here the fibrosis is jigsaw puzzle type with less of inflammation. Coming to the last, this is a 1-year-old male who had conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. HEDA scan showed non-excretion of dye. So HEDA scan is a scan wherein they put a dye into the biliary system and they see for the excretion of the dye into the lumen of the duodenum. If there is excretion, then it rules out an obstructive pathology. It is not confirmative, but it just rules out an obstructive pathology. And a liver transplant specimen, the patient was 1 year, so he underwent a cadaveric transplant. And here we can see there is this jigsaw puzzle type of biliary fibrosis, irregular fibrosis. And again, in the portal or these fibrotic septae, these broad fibrotic septae, there are these ducts which are full of inspissated bile. And again here, this is a larger duct where we can see this inspissated bile and the collate stasis and feathery and giant cell transformation of the hepatocytes which can be seen. And again, this is the duct area which is showing this florid ductular reaction, edematous fibrosis with ductal bile plugs. This is from a liver biopsy. Again, here we can see this almost nodule-like formation. This is Mason's trichrome stain, and this lot of vacuolation and giant cell transformation. Again, bile ductular plugs which are full of bile. And this is CK7 stain which highlights this ductular proliferation. And again, on the hepatocytes, we can see these hepatocytes are also showing cholangular transformation. These are the intermediate hepatocytes, some of them which are showing the presence of lumina because of the cholangular transformation of the hepatocytes. Because of so much of bile which is present and collate stasis, there is the protective mechanism wherein the hepatocytes undergo this cholangular transformation to protect themselves from the bile. And again, we can see pseudo rosettes with bile, inspissated bile present in the hepatic parenchyma also. So biliary atresia, these are idiopathic inflammatory processes involving the bile ducts, obstruction of the biliary tract causing chronic cholecystitis, progressive fibrosis, and eventually it causes biliary type of cirrhosis. Etiology is not clear. There is early and late type of biliary atresia, and HEDA scan, as I said, that is hepatic imaging to see secretion of dye into the duodenum, and the presence of dye, if it is excreted into the duodenum, that rules out an obstructive pathology, it rules out biliary atresia. And during Kasai, sometimes when a patient is diagnosed early, they do a portoenterostomy so that the portoenterostomy can sustain the patient at the age of 1 to 2 years, wherein he can sort of sustain the liver transplant. So a per op cholangiogram is done during operation also. And again, the same principle applies wherein excretion of the dye is looked for. Here, the extrahepatic biliary or the intrahepatic biliary tree, both can be affected. So earlier it used to be called extrahepatic biliary atresia. Now it is just biliary atresia. There is obstructive picture both clinically and histopathologically. Biliary cirrhosis develops early in life within the first 6 to 7 months. Those who survive infancy because of a successful drainage, Kasai portoenterostomy, continue to have this intrahepatic bile duct damage with recurrent cholangitis and cholestasis, and therefore they need a liver transplant later in life. And this biliary atresia needs to be differentiated from neonatal hepatitis. So portal changes are most important, that is ductular proliferation, a lot of ductular proliferation, prominent bile plugs with bridging and portal fibrosis. It is seen in biliary atresia as compared to neonatal hepatitis, which will not show so much of bridging or extensive fibrosis. It can maximum show till F2 fibrosis, and ductular proliferation, bile plugs are not seen in neonatal hepatitis usually. And parenchymal changes can be seen in both, like giant cells, myeloid metaplasia, etc. So to summarize, carcinoma GB, highest incidence in the northern part of the country, Gangetic belt, gallstone disease, I discussed a bit about the pathogenesis and pigment stones. It can be cholesterol or pigment, which is brown and black. And the most important is the metaplasia dysplasia carcinoma sequence. And it is required to differentiate reactive atypia from invasive carcinoma and invasive carcinoma from involvement of Rokitansky-Ashoff syndrome, sinuses, pre-invasive lesions like Billin, high grade and low grade. Xanthogranulomatous cholecystitis is a mimic of CAGB, and intraductal papillary neoplasm of bile duct is type 1 and type 2. Type 2 is more common in the extrahepatic duct. Cholangiocarcinoma etiology and liver flukes, especially in the eastern part of the world, Southeast Asia, and periampillary tumors. Ampillary having a better prognosis than the distal cholangiocarcinoma, and which is better than pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma. Cholangitis can be primary and secondary. Primary especially has to be differentiated from IgG4 related cholangitis. And I just told a few lines about biliary atresia. Happy Guru Nanak Jayanti, and thank you. This was a very long lecture. I'm sorry.
No, we should not be sorry. We should be very thankful to you. Wonderful. And you have covered almost everything. It took you 90 minutes. You must be very tired, I think.
I tried to, sir, because it was a large lecture. So, but I didn't still cover cholecystitis.
Whatever is relevant has been taken care of. And no, cholecystitis is okay. People will read it out on their own.
Yes.
The
yes.
Tough ones have been covered very well, especially the PSC and the IgG4 disease.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Those are from the cases that we saw at ILBS.
So. Oh, is it? Great. So, there are no questions on the YouTube, and neither there are any questions here. Thank you so much, Dr. Sunaina. God bless you. Very nice presentation. Please share the PDF so that we can share with everybody. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Take care. Good night.
Thank you, sir. Good night.